Hello, greetings to everyone. Welcome to VTU eShikshana program. We are dealing with the course for BR 6th semester, the course titled Building Services 3, 18 ARC 63 for the session April to August 2021. I, Dr. Dakshayani R. Patil, Associate Professor at BMS College of Architecture, Bengaluru, welcome all of you to proceed with our further sessions, which we have already commenced for the modules 1 and 2. So currently we are on the module 1, dealing with mechanical ventilation and air conditioning, the introductory aspects. Module 2 will deal with air conditioning systems and details. So to give an overview of the syllabus, the objective is to equip the students with the understanding of the mechanical services in buildings and their integration with the architectural design. So we have started with module 1 and completed some of the portions under both the sections. In this current lecture class, we are going to see and take a look at the basics of load calculations, zoning, air distribution and heating systems. Alright, so module 2 will be further ahead. So to commence this particular section, quick glance at the references listed by in the syllabus. So module 1, section 2, so that's why I will call it as 1.2, will deal with basics of heat load calculations, to begin with the various parameters towards the heat load calculations would be understood. And to give a brief, very quick glance at what we can expect, we will look at the heat load components, parameters, the concept of thermal zoning, the various formulas in place to calculate the heat load. So to begin with, understanding the load, heat load components. Heating and cooling load calculations are primarily dependent on these four listed aspects: the building location, indoor design conditions, building orientation, and building construction. So, and there are subheadings under this. Now, why are we wanting to understand the heat load components and the calculations? It lies with the objective that when we are designing a building, a space for air conditioning or mechanical ventilation, we need to know what is the total heat gained by the building, right? Only if we know that, we can calculate the capacity or cooling load of our air conditioning system. So, and it's not an easy task. It has it has quite a diverse list of parameters in a building which will lead to the total heat gain. The building is on the land. It is surrounded by so many things. There is a solar sun, solar energy which is coming on it. Then there are different elements of the building itself that will contribute to the overall heat load generation in the building. So if it is X is the heat load, so what should be my cooling load? Every building is different, it is subjective, hence a set of formulas in place, time tested and proficient in getting down to the total heat gain. Based on this, the engineer, the consultant and the architect will decide on what is a suitable air conditioning system that can be designed for the building. To do this, the formulas are in place. So normally it's an extensive calculation, Microsoft Excel, can come handy, but also the use of commercial software to calculate the heating load and the cooling load greatly simplifies the process. But then again, we have to know what are the parameters for calculation. There are quite a number of software on the web, some worldwide with global appeal. There are some very specific to Indian context and provided by Indian service providers. So this is one. You may have a lot of these giving tutorials and also free trials, but this is a paid software. Then coming to our own ISHRE, the Indian Society of Heating, Refrigeration and Air Conditioning Engineers, also has floated a smart energy software on their website, which can be easily found, and it gives a very extensive detail on how to go about. Similarly, there's one more, nzeb.in. So relevant to our context, it talks about load calculation, the procedures, cooling equipment, heating equipment, design, operation, maintenance, environment impact of the refrigeration, building management services, which we have seen in class number one, BMS, desiccant cooling, evaporative cooling, solar air conditioning, etc. You can toggle between these tabs and get a very good understanding on HVAC, passive design, lighting also. And it it's quite an extensive website. When you flow down, you will know what are the rules of thumbs. But then again, it is understood that rules of thumbs are not to be adopted in large-scale buildings. They will be not too reliable. There are lots of tables which will give the tentative heat outputs by certain elements. So kindly go through this nzeb.in, Knowledge Center. There are many more you can browse through. Now, word of caution with respect to the load components, as like I already mentioned, heat load estimation for design and selection of air conditioning and refrigeration is a vast and complex subject. It has many, many parameters influencing on arriving at the suitable AC loads and refrigeration capacities. The ton of refrigeration, which is a unit for measuring refrigerator quantum. So heat load estimation is not a simple process, but extensive and detailed. Complexities are there, but as long as we know what we are doing, we know the parameters that have to be considered and the formulas in place for calculation, the standards in place, it becomes easier. Hence, acquainting with NBC, BIS, IS codes, ASHRAE standards, ISHRAE related standards, all these will help us in being aware and then taking care of the estimation in a smooth manner. This needs to be done carefully and as accurately as possible. Because once you arrive at a parameter, you design the building, you conceptualize a HVAC system, and it becomes a faulty or a system which is designed based on erroneous numerical calculations, it is going to be a very dire scene. HVAC involves a lot of investment, a lot of technical designing, which cannot be undone that easily. So we have to be careful and as accurately as possible. Successful performance of AC air conditioning depends on this accuracy by the engineer and the architect. So that is hence this entire component of load calculation based on the parameters is a crucial aspect of understanding refrigeration and air conditioning. Now, how do we calculate the loads? Do we calculate it in the morning, in the night, in the evening? So, or do you sit for days together and check out? It is good if we do that, but then there is something called a sampling also. So in this case, the sampling would be the peak conditions for a given place. Now, what is a peak outside condition? It is that date and time of the year when sustained peak conditions prevail. So peak conditions that prevail, that are tabulated or noticed over a period of time, will contribute to the peak outside condition. It is based on this load calculations and worked out ahead. It has to be judiciously done. There has to be precision and the margin of error as minimal as possible. The principle behind identifying peak conditions is choosing a date and an hour with effective room total heat being the maximum. So this is the outdoor design conditions as prescribed in National Building Code Volume 2, which we all can refer for different cities. If you notice to the left side, beginning with Ahmedabad, Akola, Allahabad. So NBC has listed the average outdoor design conditions for various cities in India. The list goes ahead. Up to 60 cities, the documentation is in place for reference to be referred when projects are dealt in any of these cities. But apart from these, whatever design conditions are listed for the 60 cities, in case the city is not included in the list, it is recommended that extrapolation may be done from the data of the nearby listed city to whichever city listed is near to the town or city that we are looking for. It can be extrapolated, but keeping into consideration the specific topographical and climatic conditions of the concerned location. So the point to note is there are various standards in our case, the NBC, where most of the already researched or documented data is in place for cities or places that we're looking for, design conditions with respect to temperature, pressure, average parameters are listed, and these can be ready reckoners for us to design our HVAC systems based on the data already available. But then localized data has to be projected or analyzed by the architect. Now that was about outdoor design conditions, which are already documented and also would be subjective to the places of design in question. Coming to indoor design conditions. So there are two parameters of design conditions, the outdoor and the indoor. With respect to the indoor design conditions, which also is listed in NBC, the formulas in place, it is as per the adaptive thermal comfort model. So human comfort levels are in place with respect to temperature, pressure, air velocity, stagnation, etc. But apart from that, humans have a tendency to adapt to the local climate over a period of time. So now let us look three categories under this, under the design for indoor environmental situations. The first one, for naturally ventilated buildings. So we are looking with the case study of buildings that are naturally ventilation in place. So the following equation should be used for design and operation of the naturally ventilated buildings. It indicates that occupants in naturally ventilated buildings thermally adapt to the outdoor temperature of their location. That's a human physiological tendency. It is based on the 30-day outdoor running mean temperature. So average or mean temperature for a 30-day period is considered. The indoor operative temperature would be 0.54 into the outdoor temperature calibrated plus factor of 12.83. So where indoor operative temperatures are neutral temperature and the outdoor temperature is the 30-day outdoor running mean temperature. So we are talking about two aspects here, the indoor operative temperature, because it is again added on to the outdoor temperature with the energy output that happens within the building. The 90% acceptability range for the India specific adaptive models for naturally ventilated buildings is around plus or minus 2.38 degrees Celsius. The second category for analyzing indoor design conditions, we will look at mixed mode buildings. So what does NBC say? Mixed mode buildings are where HVAC is operated only during required situations, during extreme outdoor conditions. They are becoming more prevalent in India. So we do not run HVAC all along the year, even when it's not necessary, but rather we adopt these HVAC facilities only during extreme outdoor conditions. The occupants in mixed mode buildings are more adaptive when compared to those in air conditioned buildings and somewhat less adaptive compared to occupants in naturally ventilated buildings. So they stay in between. Indoor operative temperature, the formula in place, 0.28 into the outdoor temperature plus 17.87 factor. So when indoor operative temperature is neutral temperature and outdoor temperature is a 30 outdoor running mean temperature. So this is the meaning for the two terminologies that are seen in the formula. The 90% acceptability range for the India specific adaptive models for mixed mode buildings is plus or minus 3.46 degrees Celsius. These formulas become essential when we are calculating the outdoor and indoor heat loads for designing our buildings. The third category, so we saw naturally ventilated buildings, mixed board and air conditioned buildings. Studies show that static predictive mean board model over predicts the sensation on the warmer side of the 7-point sensation scale in air conditioned buildings. One of the two methods should be adopted while determining indoor conditions of fully air conditioned buildings. One of these methods is based on air temperature and the other is based on standard effective temperature, which includes effect of the body surface area, relative humidity, air velocity, air temperature, radiant temperature, outdoor temperature, clothing insulation, and activity rate. So the parameters that are impacting calculation of indoor design conditions for air-conditioned buildings will depend on these listed parameters, okay, towards human comfort modulation. So design of indoor conditions as per adaptive thermal comfort method model, the first is air temperature based approach. So here the indoor operative temperature would be 0.078 into outdoor temperature plus 23.25 factor. So here, what does indoor operative temperature refer to? It means the neutral temperature, and the outdoor temperature is the 30-day outdoor running mean temperature, which is calibrated over a period of 30 days in peak period. The 90% acceptability range for the adaptive models for conditioned buildings is plus or minus 1.5 degree Celsius in Indian conditions. The second approach under this model would be standard effective temperature based approach. Standard effective temperature based approach. So the formula of calculation, the standard effective temperature is equal to 0.014 into outdoor temperature plus factor of 24.53. So in this case also, the standard effective temperature refers to the neutral temperature. Outdoor temperature refers to the 30-day outdoor running mean temperature. And the 90% acceptability range for the adaptive models for conditioned buildings is plus or minus 1 degree Celsius. The third aspect for designing the indoor comfort conditions, design conditions, minimum outside fresh air. So the table that we saw prescribes minimum supply rates of acceptable outdoor air required for acceptable indoor air quality for the different cities. These requirements for ventilation of healthcare facilities, healthcare, by healthcare we refer to hospitals, nursing and convalescent homes, are separately quoted because these are high condition or extreme clean condition requirements. These values have been prescribed to dilute human bioeffluents and other contaminants with an adequate margin of safety and to account for health variations among people and varied activity levels. So a lot of aspects are considered or listed when we begin analyzing these kind of design conditions. It is not a single attribute, but diverse attributes come into picture. Now, this the importance of indoor air quality, IAQ, refers to the quality of air in our living spaces or habitable spaces. It's one of the parameters of measuring the clarity and comfort level of the indoor environment. So what does IAQ refer to? Quality of air which affects our comfort and health. So user is the priority here, and user comfort levels and health related concerns are the priority. Most directly, it is related to the health and may result in the sick building syndrome. Sick building syndrome, we have seen earlier, it refers to poor indoor air quality and which results in acute health concerns in the people who are using that particular space. So it results in severe and recurring discomforts such as nausea, headache, eye, nose, throat infection, drowsiness, etc. And these health symptoms are localized, or they are prevalent when the person is using the area, and they disappear once out of that zone. So it becomes chronic over a period of time. Hence, indoor air quality assessment and tracking is a critical aspect of building design. Measuring the indoor air quality. Carbon dioxide is used as a surrogate ventilation index for diagnosing the ventilation efficiency in an air-conditioned area. So what we essentially do is we breathe in oxygen, we give out carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is also output of various activities and functions that happen in buildings. And it is one of the harmful ingredients or contamination in the air when not controlled. Hence, It is used as a parameter for diagnosing, for testing the air quality in an air-conditioned area. The measurement of carbon dioxide inside a conditioned area is an indicator of IAQ. That's why there are many carbon dioxide and carbon monoxide detectors that are placed in buildings, homes, offices, industries to track on how the air is performing. So contamination of carbon dioxide is one of the thresholds or testing parameters that is used. Odor criteria are likely to satisfy if ventilation rates are set so that 1000 parts per minute of carbon dioxide is not exceeded. So this is a benchmark or a thumb rule that is considered. However, a difference of 700 ppm, where the indoor ppm less than the outdoors, should be targeted. Building should meet accepted standards to avoid contamination through volatile organic compounds, microbial contamination, fungal, bacteria, virus, all the more very essential in the current times that we are seeing with the COVID-19 still prevalent across the world. So carbon dioxide is one of the testing parameters for analyzing and measuring the indoor air quality. There are various other methods also, and likewise there are equipment such as detectors, thermostats, which are used for the same. Now the fundamental elements in order to measure the indoor air quality, we will define under four headings. Contamination source control, detecting or figuring out what is the source of contamination, and of course taking measures to mitigate the same, control the same, proper ventilation, designing our buildings and maintaining the required basic level of proper reasonable ventilation in the spaces, prerogative. Humidity management. Humidity also is a cause of concern because it has its own impact on various aspects of the building element and growth of fungus and various other dispersing organic volatile compounds which are harmful for the users. So keeping track of the RH also is essential, also absolute humidity. Adequate filtration to clean the air. So what is the filtration method that the architect would prescribe is essential. We are going to do a chapter on filtration ahead in the module 2. Now NBC also under this table 3 has prescribed the minimum ventilation rates in breathing zones, right? So you will have to the left side, if you see the category of the building we are talking about, correctional facilities, educational facilities. Under that you have a list of subcategories like daycare, classrooms, lecture halls, laboratories, computer lab. Then you have food and beverage service, the restaurant, a cafeteria, kiosks, bars, cocktail lounges. Then the general category. The list is ahead. This is a snapshot of a part of the table. But then NBC also, like similar to how it listed the outdoor design conditions, it prescribes minimum ventilation rates that are advisable for these kind of typology of the buildings. So that can be also ready reckoners when we are designing and calibrating the heat load calculation. Like we mentioned, for healthcare facilities, there is a stipulated standard in place. This is the outdoor air requirement for ventilation of healthcare facilities, which we saw earlier for patient room, medical procedures, operating rooms, recovery and ICUs, autopsy, physical therapy, etc. Right? So it will tell you the estimated maximum occupancy, persons per 100 square meter, outdoor air requirement, and remarks. So we will refer to these tables when we are designing for any such design project under the typology. Now, we keep talking about comfort conditions and air conditioning systems, which we will provide for user satisfaction, for people being comfortable in indoors. And what are the various parameters that are considered suitable for a comfort AC? Now, this is specific to various aspects, like the location of the place in question. If it's a coastal town, there is that excess humidity levels. Where you are inlands and arid regions, the humidity is less. So the comfort conditions are specific to these kind of parameters. The location of the place, the altitude of the place, etc. However, the advisable ranges, unless specified, some average thumb rules. The inside temperature would normally be preferred around 23-24 degree. Relative humidity around between 35 to 60 should be fine. So 60 is a maximum. Air movement such as which is pleasant and not creating draft or creating stagnation. We would look for around 4.5 to 7.5 meters per minute of air movement. So these are indicating broadly the comfort conditions that may be advisable to be adopted in indoor conditions.